Okay, the noise that you can hear in the background is the noise generated by a 747 jumbo jet as we fly across the Atlantic on our way to Macon, Georgia, to join the people there from the Capricorn record label. The reason that we're going is to film the Capricorn Picnic, which is a yearly event in Macon, which is really a party which joins up all the people involved in the label, the executives from the record company, as well as the bands themselves. And we'll be filming the bands that appear at the concert there, Elvin Bishop, Marshall Tucker among them. We don't entirely know what to expect, but we're on the way, looking forward to it. And what you see next, presumably, will be what we get when we're there.
The airport of Atlantic. We're landing
2,000
feet, inspected by
Charles
Cross.
Speed's
landing about 3 minutes.
Certainly,
I've got a pleasure having you on board.
Of course, so the first thing I must do is introduce myself to you. My name is Bob Harris. I'm from London in England. And what's more, to make me even more English, I'm from BBC Television there in London. We're here for two reasons. The first of all is that Southern music, we love Southern music, and we wanted to come down and see it. And because of that, the second reason, and that's that we're filming the concert tonight to take back and show to the British people on the Old Grey Whistle Test, which is the program that we've come down to film for. So all that remains for me to do is to say you're going to have an incredible time. Welcome, Wet Willie!
Talking about life.
It's also a tremendous pleasure to introduce one of my favourite bands. Ladies and gentlemen, the Marshall Tucker Band.
Travel around the world. There's an old man sitting in a rocking chair. He got the best little dog in the county I've been told. But his shotgun done got too rusty. That old big dog is not crawling with the tool. And he stands a bit of hair on. I'm sure I could have been a wild. He feels like I'm from a wind. And they're moving in the sky. And it's a long time feeling in my mind. Feeling like I can't seem to leave my mind. Yeah, I know.
Number 16, and we're heading up now from Charleston, South Carolina, which is where we were yesterday. We were filming down there, as you know, the Marshall Tucker Band and Wet Willie. We're on our way up now to Macon, Georgia, to join the Capricorn Picnic. And with me in the truck here is Carl, who's an engineer from the studio down in Miami, and we'll be learning more about that in just a few minutes' time.
Carl is Carl Richardson, out of Criteria Sound Studios in Miami, engineer to Eric Clapton and co-producer to the Bee Gees.
It always interests me, you know, this sort of crossover from one side of the Atlantic to the other, because so many people in America say, oh, it's great to get that British sound. And working and living in London, everybody, or most people anyway, very much enjoy the American sound, you know. But I understand now that there's a big standardization going on in studio sounds in America. Westlake chain particularly.
Yes, there is. We're not a Westlake studio.
No, I know that.
But there is, yes. I still believe there are three different philosophies of recording. There are European or closely to London sound. There is the East Coast of America sound, New York sound, more or less, Miami Criteria Southern sound. There is the West Coast sound, Los Angeles, San Francisco. I still believe that those three philosophies of recording still exist, and you can pick it out in an awful lot of LPs that you'll buy today.
I was conscious last time I was over of the East Coast being heavy metal and soul, the West Coast being much more Orleans, the Eagles, you know. I was aware of that difference. Scared me to death.
Oh, I'm having a hard time following you.
Yeah.
I think the geography contributes a lot to it, especially in the South. I think this one area that we're in has a well-defined more or less sound, and its roots are really blues and country. And of course, there's New Orleans jazz thrown in, which is lovely. I think I want to go left.
Our first port of call was to a marvellous wood-built house 20-odd miles outside Macon, Georgia, to visit Dickie Betts of the Allman Brothers, to talk with him and to listen to and discover some of the roots of his own music.
Love somebody and they don't love you. There is nothing you can say. You don't want to go, but you're leaving anyway. Her beauty took me by surprise. She was the woman of my dreams. Could not see beyond her eyes. Turned around and left me somewhere in between. There ain't nothing you can do.
Very young, I remember the radio, you know, sitting in the kitchen window, you know, sitting there as a little child, and Hank Williams would be singing that. He was such a powerful artist, Hank Williams. You know, he's an immortal artist here in this country. And that has influenced my lyrics and singing style, you know, more. And Jimmy Rogers, of course, goes back into the 30s. Jimmy Rogers is called the father of country music. And he's influenced me quite a lot.
Something about you, mama, sure give me the blues. Something about you, mama, sure give me the blues. It ain't your dark stitch stockings. It ain't your blue buckle shoes. Beautifully.
Style that would go along with the Jimmy Rogers period, you know, would be Blind Willie McTell played slide 12-string guitar, and in fact Blind Willie McTell wrote Statesboro Blues, and Robert Johnson is another just genius player, and of course he played solo. He didn't have any band, just did guitar himself. He wrote Crossroads, which Cream had. Played kind of pretty. Robert was real scary sound, you know, with his stuff, you know, real, and very energetic. Willie McTell wrote Statesboro Blues. He played more like a 12-string lead. That's the base of just about all of American music, those two.
When we arrived in Macon, we met the man who began working with Otis Redding, formed a record label with the money he made, and with it created one of the strongest label identities in the world. The label is Capricorn, its owner Phil Walden, and we met up to see one of Macon's historical musical areas.
The building we're standing in front of was known as Ann's TikTok, which was the location that Little Richard performed many, many times in the early days of his career. Matter of fact, the legend has it the song Ms. Ann is reportedly written about Ann, who owned the bar and, according to Little Richard, raised him during the early days. This would be around, this would be in the late 50s, and from that, well, Little Richard was pretty much the first to emerge in the area, and then James Brown, then Otis Redding, and in the rock era, we of course had the Almonds, and Wet Willie, and Marshall Tucker. And the theater we're approaching, the Douglas Theater, goes way back. It has a whole lot of black history wrapped up in that location. It goes back to the old black vaudevillian days and whatnot. It's my understanding that Bessie Smith played here. A lot of the greats of that era.
Yeah. How did you get involved yourself?
Well, I was a fan primarily, and I wanted to be a singer, and I couldn't sing. So the next step was to become involved in some fashion. And I met some guys that wanted to form a singing group, black guys, and they were having an amateur contest every Saturday morning here with a live broadcast. And this one entertainer kept beating my group out, and that entertainer was Otis Redding. So I added one and one, and it made two. And so I approached Otis Redding about becoming involved with him, and we started a relationship that lasted for some 10 or 12 years.
Yeah, because this is the Douglas Theater right here now.
This is where I would come to find musicians when I needed musicians. Come down here, they'd be in the pool room or the barber shop. And in the latter days, that whole concept of stage show was sort of fading, and black music had a broader base. It moved up to the old City Auditorium, and that was where I first saw Little Richard perform, and where I really became a real fan and started going to the black shows.
Phil, thanks very much indeed.
Thank you.
And we'll see you at the picnic.
All night, tomorrow, midday tomorrow. See, I'll be cooking my kid all the way through the picnic as they're going through. See, I'll be sending back as before. On the last end, then I come out.
just left the hotel on our way now to the Capricorn picnic itself. And with me is Billy Joe.
Yeah.
What are we going to expect when we get there now?
I don't know, I ain't never been there before.
Okay, we've just arrived now at Lakeside for the Capricorn picnic, and we're going to get off the bus and join everybody just down there. First of all, thank you very much for sparing the time to speak with me today. I know that you are very interested in rock music.
Yes, I am. I'm not only interested in it from what it signifies in our society, but also I enjoy it. And in addition to that, I have a close friendship with some of the performing groups and have been helped greatly by them during the campaign. We have a strict limit on how much any one person can contribute to the campaign financially, and some of the recording groups have helped a lot.
How much of an influence do you feel that rock music is a cultural influence, really, in America today?
Well, I think it's had a profound influence during times of difficult social change in the Vietnamese War and in the Civil Rights Movement, in the struggle concerning environment, and the desire of young people to let their voices be heard more effectively in the political world. In all these ways, people like Bob Dylan and Simon Garfunkel and the Allman Brothers and others have expressed in clear terms to the young people a basic philosophy, I think, of enlightenment and compassion, the alleviation of racial discrimination, a search for peace, the worth of the human being. This had a profound effect on the consciousness, not only of young people, but of old people like me.
How's it going, Phil?
I'm all right. Yeah. Listen, first of all, Alvin, let's take you back to your own roots in music. How did you first get involved with rock and roll music?
Well, actually, I started off as being kind of like a real blues fan enthusiast, you know, and I didn't want to play anything but blues for about the first 5 years that I played. And I'm from Tulsa, Oklahoma. And when I was about 17, I went to Chicago, and that's when I first started playing guitar. And the reason I went to Chicago was because I heard there was a blues scene there. And there was, and I just dove into it. I loved it. And at that time, I didn't want to hear nothing but blues. All the rest of the music was BS to me, you know.
How did you get involved with Paul Butterfield?
I met him in Chicago. I met him the first day I got there. He was sitting down on some steps playing a guitar. See, he played guitar before he played harmonica, and I played harmonica before I played guitar. But we gradually found out what was best for us, you know. I played with his band for about 4 or 5 years. As a matter of fact, I was in England with Butterfield, I think in 68 or 69. Yeah? We're on a tour with Eric Burdon and Georgie Fame, a bunch of other people. And After that, I started, you know, I grew up in Oklahoma, so naturally, I'd get up in the morning, go to school, and there'd be country and western on the TV every morning. So I knew about that. And after a while, I started saying, wait a minute, I don't live on no plantation in Mississippi, and I've never picked no cotton. Is this really the music that really suits my personality? So I decided to just lay back and if I got ready to write a song, just let it come out like it wanted to and not worry about what classification it would fall into.
Of mine from Los Angeles on the road. We stayed out about 12 weeks and did the old every night, you know, six nights a week, two shows a night. From here to New York, no manager, nothing, you know, no agent. We did it ourselves with the help of Ike Turner. And by the time we got to New York, we were just monsters.
Yes, I'll see you with that girl and I caught you in a lie.
just been playing football, right?
But we're just leaving now to go over crosstown to Uncle Sam's for the performance there later on of Stillwater, and there'll be a lot of people jamming on stage. Hopefully we'll be seeing Dickie Betts. You can probably hear the cars behind me leaving now, so let's go.
Good night, everybody. We'll see you later. Thanks a lot.
The music was fantastic, and so was the atmosphere, and I hope some of that feeling has come across through this film. Macon Whoopee.